There's still some muffins on those trays out there, and it's a big mistake. So I want to rethink that strategy somewhere along the line. Why don't we go around and introduce ourselves? John, you want to start?
Sure. John Callahan, local metro government.
I'm Brian Gibson, Park City.
Jim Moody with NDOT Seymour District.
Andy Crouch, City of Jeffersonville.
Dylan Bishop, Town of Clarksville.
Tom Hall, KRT, City of Clarksville.
Thomas Willett, KRT, City of St. Paul office.
I'm KRT, City of St. Paul office.
Barry Park with Torrey.
I'm Matt Wilk, I'm the Chief District Engineer for Park and Highway District.
Larry Chaney with KRT.
Phil Perry, the City of Jeffersonville.
Marty Bowling, City of St. Paul.
Jerry Palmer, City of Charlotte.
Randy Yeh, City of Jeffersonville.
Nancy Snow, Tarrant, and Bridge Mobility Council.
Hi, you're talking to Todd.
Todd, I'm ready to meet you, engineers.
Sean Dax, WSP, Parsons, Baker Hall.
Ron Jevon, Forest, Cole.
David Burke, with KRT.
I'm Mary Lee Palmer, with KRT.
Nick Mayo, with KRT.
Adam Forsett, KRT.
Andy Rush, KRT.
Ashley Anderson, KRT.
Jerry Miller, State House.
Amanda Dufford, with KRT. Sarah Berry, KRT.
Randy Sapp, KRT.
Lori Kelsey, with KRT.
Bob Stock, United Consulting.
Tim Mitchell, Brown Hall.
Krista Robinson, Congressman, Town of Ramos office.
Stacy Burke, Chickens Ride, KRT.
Morning, welcome. You have in front of you the October 27th meeting minutes. We've got a motion, we've got a second. Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Public comment period. Do we have any public comments? Public meeting report, Ashley.
On November 10th, we attended the Bullock County luncheon with State Treasurer Allison Paul. On November 15th, we were at the 17 Indiana ACE Awards. And November 18th, we went to the Sustainability Director's Brown Bag Luncheon at Global Metro.
Any comments? All right, it is my great pleasure at this point to introduce Matt Polo, who's going to stand in for KYTC Transportation Secretary Greg Thomas, to give us an update on the tech transportation.
All right, good morning.
Morning.
I was asked to stand in for Secretary Thomas, who got me here today. He gives advice for several of the NPO meetings at the end of the year, often he can't cover them all, so I think late Thursday afternoon, I'm asked to step in. Larry gave some pointers on what I'm going to talk about today, so here I am. So what I'm going to do is kind of mix it. Obviously, I'm from District 5, local districts, but also we talk about the statewide perspective. So I'll talk about some of our accomplishments for 2016, what kind of problems we've run into, and then I'll look towards the future a little bit as well. Feel free to stop me at any point in time and ask questions if you see something you don't understand or want more information about. So that's the way to get started. So, obviously, Governor Bevin's been in going on almost a year now. So when he first came in, he had several points of emphasis. He didn't call it points of emphasis, but I call it points of emphasis because as I was watching the basketball game the other night, it seems like every year at the beginning of the season, the commentators on TV say, that's a new point of emphasis for this year. They're not going to let all the we got to come back in and do this kind of stuff. I'm like, if that's a rule last year or 10 years ago, then why do they have to call it point? We'll play over their points of emphasis for Governor Bevin. Reduce auto active duties. I think every governor who's come in has said that, but there's some rural moves and changes on the emphasis on those things. Consolidating boards and commissions. Well, if you've seen the news or read the newspapers, you know that he's actually acting on that pretty drastically. So, employees down to 2007 levels.
closely, make sure we're efficient.
20% reduction in the governor's office.
He's already done that. He's reduced the staff in the governor's office.
Competitive bid as much as possible. We already knew competitive bidding, but one thing we added this year, which I think is a very good thing, is reverse auctions. All that is, let's say, either a material, a purchase order for materials or another kind of service out there, and you have almost like a blind auction. It's not completely blind, but people get on websites and they bid below, keep going down until the bidding time is up, as opposed to where you normally try to bid up to get something, they bid down, they really want it, but they want to provide a service, so keep going down. It's turned out really well. We're going to continue that program. Liquidation of excess right of way. We've always done this as well, but we're going to do a little more aggressively now. Anytime we have properties out there that were purchased for, say, interchange or interstate or anywhere else, it's got to sit there. Call them odd lots because we still have to maintain some of those and it costs money to do so. So we're all for those. A lot of you or some of you may have heard of this thing called Paul's 50. It's a little catchphrase we've been using all year. We'll continue to use it. And really, to sum it up very quickly, is for fiscal year 17, we're basically pausing all state funding expenditures for capital projects, construction. It doesn't have to be just construction. It could be design phase, right-of-way phase, utility relocation phase, or construction. 2017 pausing, basically, fiscal year. For fiscal 18, which starts to go out next year, plan is for about $50 million in state expenditures. That could be for any of those phases again. So, obviously, when you press the pause button on the program, things start to back up a little bit. So, pause button, hit play button next year. We actually have some kind of prioritization process, and we're just starting that process. But the process already been started, we're really getting to the meat of it right now. Because when July 1st next year comes around, we'll be able to hit the ground running. It won't necessarily mean we're going to jump right into construction projects. We may have some other phases that will authorize those monies. I don't expect you to be able to read all the numbers on this chart, but I use it for demonstration purposes mainly. This is our cash flow, daily cash balances. Obviously, at the beginning of the year over here, the beginning of the fiscal year over here, July 15, doing really well, and there's a lot of fluctuations. Every time around August of the year, you may look August and August. August is one here. The easiest way to explain that is it's like a credit card payment. We have lots of debt service out there, little projects, bonds, federal funds, government bonds, we have to pay those back. And that time every year is when we make a pretty substantial payment. So that is one of the main reasons why we brought it down. So when you're looking, if you're in this area, you're looking at this, obviously if you've got a bank account at home, you're in the red. Well, it's probably in the red as well. So this was the outlook. So well, in late last year, actually in the middle of last year, in late last year, we started looking seriously at what we needed to do to fix the situation. That's where the Paul's 50 came from. But we also looked at our maintenance budget, which is the state funds set aside by the legislature, the budget every 2 years. So we had to look at cutting various activities. And we did a good job of that and didn't get to this point. So we've done business as usual from here, like I said. We've got to these 2 points. So we did get to these 2 points. We maintain about this 100 billion operating level, which is, I think it's actually statute that we're supposed to keep $100 million level. Approximately, you know, it's going to fluctuate from approximately $12 million a day to a transportation tax expense on operating expenses and various other expenditures. So that's really only about, you know, a week to 10 days of funds for $100 million. Why are we in this situation? Well, I explained some of it already. The next one is the first one up there is the gas tax. Remember the session 14, I guess, when this was a big item. The term everybody heard was freezing the floor. Well, Second factor is we were somewhat overextending ourselves on state funds. Several years ago, decided we were trying to do $1 billion of lettings every year. That's of course state funds plus federal funds. But state funding size where we were overextending our authority somewhat. And then we have the carryover from any construction projects, an obligated balance at the end of 15 years was almost double over about a 4-year period. So we take all those factors in. So some of it we had no control over, some of it we had control over, some of our spending. So now we're hitting the pause button, gathering, letting the coffers fill back up a little bit before we move forward with a more sustainable plan. Another demonstration chart there show our fiscal years down at the bottom, sorry, down to fiscal year 10 and projecting out to 18. This area right here is where we go. Our expenditures are over our revenue, and we continue that for a while. We don't expect to get back above water, above our head above water, I guess, until later this year. So where does that leave us? Where is, you know, some of these projects that you care about statewide? We have ongoing commitments with a very, what we call mega projects. Obviously, the Global Bridge projects listed on there. It is basically done. We still have some closeouts, punchless items that will need to be finished and paid out. But we still have I-69 improvements, Mountain Parkway is very robust, continued on. And the bridges, the lake bridges, I guess, is referred to 68, 80, as I mentioned, the federal funding levels are, with our authorization, fast times, we still have approximately $700 million a year that we have to play with. We'll use every penny of that that we can. So there's several things that I listed there. Interchangeable county, you may heard about, we're working on right now. I-75 widening. There's also a I-565 spur between Owensboro and Bowman Creek. There's also resourcing program is state funded, approximately just shy of $100 million a year. So you may be wondering, what about that money? Where's that coming from? Well, with some of the cost savings measures we've done throughout the states, and we've actually deobligated some unused authorized funds that have been unused on various phases of a bunch of projects, we've come up with about $140 million that we have. And that's where the resourcing program is still going. Things a little bit slower as far as letting those resourcing projects out, but we're still going to max about that $100 million this year. And local and city governments will continue to utilize our flex funds and their also local programs, rural municipal aid, I guess, more appropriately, and bridge replacement programs. Bottom line there, red, we are not stopping work on encumbered contracts. Biggest example for us locally is is Ring Road in Old County, state funded project, 11 Foley, 13 million, somewhere in that neighborhood. Okay, she's going. That's a state funded project. We have 761 Bull County from Shepherdsville coming up north. That area, that's about $40 million project. So there are several projects throughout the state that are state funded. They were led last year, work started. Okay, so awards for 2016, so this year. As I said before, we were trying to sustain approximately $1 billion in construction lettings in the last 3 to 4 years. Now, I think our more appropriate need to be to shoot for the 7 to 7.50 range. As of just last week, we have awarded $540 million of projects. And with November and December lettings, we'll probably reach about the 750 range by the end of the year, mainly on the back of the federal program. All right, so maintenance is one of the items that we had to really seriously look at cutting back this year. And everything we got listed on this page here is falls into that, as we call it, FEO1, that's our maintenance program. It's funded statewide, think circled on here, because of the two things that are some of the most important things that we can cut. So here we are, snow and ice storage spending, I think this is a very interesting chart. Obviously, back in 2008, 2016, the cost fluctuates pretty wildly. And if you look back, which I've done for a few years, look back into what our actual annual snowfall is for some of those years, it doesn't correlate very well. We probably spent more money in those years where we don't have a whole lot of accumulation, but we need to nickel and dime, as you know, every time it snows, we send the guys out there, and they do their thing. If it's 5 inches of snow, they go out there and do the same thing, if it's 1 inch of snow, they have the same wraps to cover, the same, unless it continues to snow after that. So, 2012, 2013, we had some good years, because we only spent the neighborhood of $30-$40 million, but then we had 2015, where we were in the $90 million range. So, one thing I want to point out is, of our state-owned trucks across the state, we have about 1,000 of those. We supplement those with 432 contract trucks. The average retrofit cost is about $28,000 per contract truck. Retrofit cost means this is what we pay the contractors to basically stick a plow in a salt bed and a spreader box on their truck. If it doesn't snow the entire year, $28,000 per truck. In District 5, the rural area, the surrounding 7 counties, we have about 95 contract trucks. We almost have a quarter of those. The hourly rates for those truck drivers, that's contract truck drivers, is $9 per hour. So after we pay the $28,000 just to have a truck, every time it snows, it's an 8 or 12 hour shift, it's $9 per hour. So why do I point all that out? It's very expensive. But you're also looking at one of Governor Devin's initiatives is, you may have heard recently, the announcement for raises for a bunch of our CDL drivers and some of our labor classifications. The point is to build those guys up, get more of those guys coming in, working for the states, and maybe have less contract workers. So that's another cost saving measure we're looking forward to. It's going to take a while to implement it. This is something that Secretary Thomas and State Highway Engineer Patty Dunaway planned to come out and do a press conference. They were supposed to have it last week, canceled it, it's going to be next week. Talk about some of our new snow and ice policy changes. Our policy used to say we would go out there, no matter what happened, we'd go out there, we'd stay out there and do a bare pavement on all of our roads. Sounds good, right? Well, nobody else does that. The county barns, the Shelby County, the Oakland counties, they don't do that, right? You don't hit every road and make sure it's complete.
Counties, yeah.
Yep.
Yes. Yeah, all of our roads, after our second month, we want our roads, if it's not ice, we want to start showing the airbag on our county.
We had a policy that basically said you run there until you have air pavement everywhere. Well, that's still a goal. We still may do that, but it's not an absolute. The reason why I say that is because we've done some more prioritizations. We've actually prioritized routes, made some emergency routes. We didn't have that before. We used to have A's and C routes. That was A for high priority and C for lower priority. Now we have emergency routes. And those are your interstates, even roads that are not interstates that are, say, lead to a major industry or a hospital or something like that. C routes. We one policy change that's going to be more significant probably in our counties and rural areas is that we're not going to address the C routes after hours and dark, basically. After our second shift, say. That was something we did. And that was several reasons why we're doing that. Again, some of the counties don't do that during the dark. You got some of your curvy, windiest, lower volume roads. You got these big trucks, we have a lot of young drivers, it's just a recipe for disaster. We've pulled up our snow truck, our trucks out of ditches for sea grass. So we're going to be pulling back to the sea grass.
Can I ask a question? What type of road we talk about? That's not
about strictly on the state network, you're talking about super low volume. Out in the county, that means you can which county or state roads.
Here's a generalization, a state with a route number that's probably a four-digit number is going to be a C route.
Okay, you can maybe back me a little bit more.
That'd be a C route.
That'd be a C route. So yeah, it'd be terrible though if we all take our way.
All they would have to be doing is going down there at night. If we get it there in the day, just run away from that.
Well, you may get away from you through the night though, so we can get back in safety.
We have a situation on all roads though, so we're just saying that's the most priority. I don't know if that is, but it probably is. Sharing your resources, we've always done that, but we're concentrating more on cross-district sharing your resources because every time a snow event or a sleet event or ice event comes in, there's always parts of the state obviously that aren't in the line of parks. Whether that be along the river, it's of course out and everywhere else, so cross-district sharing resources. And I've already talked about best contract service, and we'll also reduce the amount of contract throughout the same space and money. That hasn't really been discussed. I mean, I guess our ideal situation is to get more of our guys that are the cheapest out there to do that. That's not out of the question, but we're trying to eliminate the contracts, I guess, at this point. That is still being done. We're not going to let the angels know.
We have a lot of going through our city a lot of times. Of course, we're trying to just drive on right here.
Yeah.
Our cars can drive over the hell. We solve it like that. We can easily solve that a lot easier than you can. This is too cheap.
That's actually a discussion I had with Old Metro because they did that for us in Jefferson County. Nothing. That's one of the emergency routes. The other thing, as I mentioned on the maintenance sheet there, was one of the things that we cut this year was mowing. So the thought was, okay, we need to cut our maintenance budget. What can we look at? We also looked at lawn mowing, striping, a little bit mowing. So on mowing, we have two types of mowing generally, type two and type three. We've always used type three for the most part statewide. Type three basically is pretty simple. Mow the entire right of way. Everything that we own out there, we pretty much mow. Also, the important thing about the type 3 mowing was that we also want to wrap around signs and things like that. So, obviously, about more area cover possible. We decided to go with type 2 this year. Type 2 is basically you take a 15-foot swath on either side of the shoulder of your roadway. If you have an interstate and a median, if you have anything less than 15 feet left over, if you hit those two 15 foot swaths, you have to mow the median. So that's why you probably see, maybe on the scene side, or you have a stand of 3 foot grass where everything else is done there in the median. So we also cut a cycle. So on top of that, we're going to type two, we cut a cycle. Type two mowing, kind of in line with NDOT and Tennessee does. So we looked at both those states and said, hey, that didn't look so bad. It saved a whole lot of money. So we looked into doing that. Well, we're not doing that anymore. We did that for one season, and I think the governor decided he wanted to turn that back around. So what we're going to go back to is probably type three with one less cycle. We probably still do some type two on Gene Snyder, particularly. There's some really worth buying areas there. I don't have the numbers on what we save and what the cost differences are, but they are astronomical difference. So that is one thing that the government benefit is all about, and we're working hard to try to get there because that's days of cleanliness and mowing as part of that. When we were doing type 2 mowing earlier in the summer, I got a call from Secretary Thomas, who got a text from the governor, who said, and we need to go to trim. Where the type 2 mowing does not trim around signs, delineators, guardrails. And so I was told Secretary Thomas, I said, well, what are you talking about here?
attended at one time. So knowing what they're kind of retro going out there and fixing and doing training, cost and time it takes, and you can't do anything else while you're doing that, since we have seven guys in Shelby County, we're just gonna go back and do it back to them. So I guess we have that to look forward to. We like to train ourselves. One other initiative that we're looking at for, started this a little bit this year, and for the good of the future with, and preventative maintenance. A lot of the counties think that's bad work, and here's why. They're gonna get, in their opinion, an inferior product, cheaper, and it's gonna take place of a resurfacing. It's not necessarily true. We're preventative maintenance is very important. It's a very, very overly simplistic chart. Because preventative maintenance can work if you do it at the right time. That is, before your pavement is completely deteriorated, and obviously not too early because of your waste of money. So there is a sweet spot between these two arrows where you wanna do preventative maintenance. That's what we're looking at, where we have about 10, 15 million dollar projects statewide for preventative maintenance. So, what is preventative maintenance? All the same, a bunch of words up there that say seal, obviously. And the whole point is obviously to seal the pavement and stop the water from getting into your cracks and so forth. So I'm not gonna go through what all those mean. Those are the different types of products and things, procedures we have out there. So we've put out several projects with those types in various areas, not in the local area yet, but hopefully probably. And we've been meeting with the local governments to describe what we're trying to do. We're not trying to give them a Band-Aid, something cheaper than resurfacing. We are trying to, yeah, save some money at the same time, extend the life of our pavements so that we don't resurface as much as we do right now. Because we're in the roads about every 15 years, and we all know that most resurfacing doesn't last that long. All right, lastly, wrap up here. I just want to plug really quickly. We have a new, used to be 511. You know, everybody used 511. There's an app out there, of course, but we closed that down November 1st. We use Waze, many use Waze, but our new website is called GoForNothingGoAnyWhy. Really what it does is it points you to Waze, but it still has interactive mapping service there. So this is the front page here when you go to, you just put okay by your address bar up there, you don't have to put anything else, it'll take you to this page. If you click up on the top thing up there, go here, it's gonna send you to the download. You go up here, it actually takes you to an interactive map. And what's neat about this is, of course, you can zoom in and out anywhere in the States, and you see the color-coded congestion on the roadways, but it also has icons and so forth for incidents, these are incidents, I guess, and camera locations and other ways, user inputs. And wherever you are zoomed in on your screen, it counts all those things for you. So in this particular view, it's actually 68 Carmark cameras. And there's also 25 signs, digital message signs. So if you click on one of the cameras, it'll pop up with the actual shots. And if you click on that, it'll actually make it more closer to full screen. So very interactive, very easy to use, very accurate as well. When you ever set the traffic down, bring up your phone, you're sitting there, and you see that you're sitting within the red line or whatever. It's pretty accurate. So, that's all I have. John, there's only, like I said, there are only going to be those few C routes that we're not in for.
Grinding.
Grinding, with pre-treat, right on.
Now, we do it a little bit less than local metro does. Of course, local metro's got majority, or well, all the state roads in Jefferson County, so you can see them doing that. We still do that. If we're looking for the right temperature, the right, how the system's coming in, and actually, there's not too much rain ahead of the system, which, as you know, a lot of times it starts and rain changes over, and we don't run.
I can't help but think that this would have been a less serious conversation about snow a week ago. Except that the last couple of days, we're all looking for where are our insulated jackets from last year. Thanks, Matt. We are privileged and honored to have with us the Commissioner of NDOT, Randy Hendrickson.
So first, let me just say, my calendar said this meeting started at 10 o'clock. So I'm going to drive around Louisville and stop for coffee and check in all the guys.
That's halfway central time.
Yeah, I know. So my apologies, certainly not the way I would want to represent NDOT. I can live. But I am glad that I got to see your presentation, and it's so great to know that we're all in this together. Everything that you just said are things that we deal with at NDOT, and you know, we struggle with our loaning cycles and you know, explaining the need for preventive maintenance, and so it was good to hear somebody else say the same things that we say all the time at NDOT. So thanks for having me here today. It feels exotic to cross the border and come into a different state to be with you guys today. So I'm glad to be here. And again, my apologies for being late. So I was late to my calendar. So we have a lot to be proud of in Indiana over the last year. And we have done just a tremendous amount of work. We invested $850 million in state projects last year. A lot of work on behalf of a lot of our NDOT employees as well as our contracting community. We repaved 580 miles of state highways, chip sealed over 1,200 miles of state roads, rehabbed and replaced 400 bridges, and serviced 3.7 million highway lane miles this past winter. We have 1,000 trucks in our snow fleet, and we're very grateful to have 70 new trucks this year. So that's a great thing. We're doing a lot more with tow plows also. So if you have one truck, one driver, two plows that can service two lanes at the same time. So that's been a really great kind of experiment over the last few years to get tow plows into our fleet. We've invested more than $200 million in the federal aid program alone in our local program. So a lot of work, not only on the NDOT side, but also investing with our local community. Another great success this year, and really was a labor of love at NDOT, was the Community Crossings Matching Grant Program. So this was a special dispensation of money from the General Assembly in Indiana to our local communities. And why it was so, well, clearly there's a need on the local side for transportation funding, but why it was so a lot of work on the side is just to make sure that the program was rolled out quickly, that it was rolled out efficiently, and that it was a very different process than the federal aid process. For our local communities, an easy application process, an easy you know, cash distribution, so they can get out and put those monies to work very quickly. We received over 1,600 applications for state projects, and they ranged anywhere from purchasing material to do chip seal to, you know, total road reconstruction. We capped the award at $1 million, and several of the communities around here received Community Crossings matching grant dollars. So it was a 50-50 matching grant program. And it was such a great week to go around the state of Indiana and hand out these gigantic checks to mayors and a lot of communities that just never really really that we dealt with very often because of the federal aid process, you know, being something that some communities just aren't able or willing to do. But just really great to see some of those communities come to the table with an application. Part of the requirement of the matching grant program was that the communities had an asset management plan. So a lot of kudos went out to those communities who worked very quickly to get asset management plans for their roads and bridges approved and to make them eligible for those funds. So again, $160 million awarded just last year. This just gives a little view into how we spend our money at NDOT. Really, it's something that we're very proud of because over almost 70% of our budget goes to capital improvement. So the blue area is actually our capital program, but also in there, our maintenance work program makes up 4% also of our funding, and that, you know, obviously is our maintenance forces doing doing road bridge improvements as well. So just a lot of you know, streamlining of our workforce, and you know, trying to be more efficient so that we can use those dollars to invest in our assets. This is the breakdown of our capital program, and you'll see in fiscal year 17 that we are investing substantially in preservation. So over the course of the last, you know, 10 or so years, when we, what we call our major moves era, that's when we did a lot of big capital, major capacity type projects with funds that were generated from the lease of the Indiana Toll Road. And it was a, you know, just record-breaking expenditure in added capacity and reconstruction in Indiana. But now as we kind of transition out of that era and turn towards really a new era of preservation and of taking care of what we have. So you'll see that reflected here as we look forward in our preservation program. We have a record number of preservation projects this year, more than any other year in the history of NDOT. So definitely an increased focus there. And part of it is, you know, goes along the lines with what you just heard relative to preventive maintenance, but also our customers, year after year after year, tell us that taking care of roads and bridges are is really the most important thing to them. So we know that investing early in preservation is important to extend the life of our assets, but also our customers tell us that after removing snow and ice from highways, that taking care of roads and bridges is the most important thing to them. Now, it is interesting to hear about mowing, because while mowing is doesn't even make the list here, but it, our survey tells us that mowing is not that important to people when you compare it to snow and ice and taking care of what we have. Our customer calls that come into our district offices, you know, don't necessarily reflect that, because we do get a lot of customer inquiries and a lot of legislative inquiries, as well as information that comes from our local officials about the need for us to, you know, invest more in mowing. So like Kentucky, it's also, you know, a struggle that we have in Indiana to figure out, you know, what's that sweet spot in terms of, you know, making sure that that our constituents are served well, that our state is, you know, aesthetically represented well, and also not investing too heavily so that we can take care of those roads and bridges. It costs us about $4 million per cycle to mow in Indiana. And so it's quite a substantial investment you know, that we make. So we're looking at different ways to you know, be more community specific, to work closer with our local officials on you know, spot improvements and things like that that may help that was also over the last few legislative sessions, a special allocation of funds from our Indiana General Assembly to add capacity on our major interstates in Indiana. So you can see the map there, it's kind of hard to see, but $500 million, $500 million allocated for those major moves 2020 trust fund projects. I-65, south of Indianapolis, several locations that you see there have been a recipient of these additional funds. Another major project, so while we're focusing on preservation, we are also at the same time doing some big things at NDOT. So we announced with your governor last June that we would be pursuing a partnership with Kentucky to advance the Ohio River Crossing project, a new bridge that will connect I-69 between Evansville and Henderson. And working with QITC, we selected Parsons to as our consulting firm to start the preliminary design and the environmental process to get that project going. Another big thing that we're doing in Indiana is we believe that this year all of the stars are aligned for additional transportation funding in Indiana. So we feel like we have the support of the General Assembly, and then our governor-elect Holcomb has made it clear that infrastructure is certainly a priority of his as well. So over the last, this fall, I've been participating in what we call the first task force, two S's, the funding Indiana's roads for a stronger, safer tomorrow is what FIRST stands for. And we've had three meetings. We have another one scheduled early next month. And the charge of this task force is to, by the beginning of January, hand over a recommendation to the General Assembly for consideration for additional funding to be identified for transportation. We presented information to the task force in July that shows that Indiana has anywhere from a $250 million to $1.4 billion gap in transportation funding, depending on what you want to buy. So just to meet our asset targets in terms of bridge and pavement condition is about a $250 million gap per year to get us to the level of condition that we want. Once you throw in the added capacity and congestion and safety projects that are necessary, that our industry tells us are important, just making sure that we continue to be economically viable. It's about and growing regional needs as well, it's about a $1.4 billion per year gap. So I'm very optimistic that something will happen in the legislature this year that will allocate additional funds for transportation in Indiana. What that looks like, your guess is as good as mine. What I have learned in my job is that all the magic seems to happen the last 3 days of session, and to speculate, does no good. So I will be very anxious to see what comes out of session, and we'll just be, be prepared to spend and effectively whatever funds that we receive. So here's the map. You guys are probably very familiar with this as well, being part of the Midwest, and we just have so much logistic transportation being the crossroads of America and Indiana. Just major investments in our interstate highways and just a tremendous amount of truck traffic that flows through our states. specific funding allocation for logistics. We are cognizant in everything that we do, the importance of mobility for our freight traffic, and just making sure that not only adding capacity on the interstates, building new interchanges, but also maintaining those roads and bridges are so important to the economic viability of our state. One thing that we're doing relative to freight is we have embarked on a pilot program for the hatch.com. We are using electronic weigh-in motion sensors and camera technology to weigh trucks on up in the north part of the state near Chesterton. And we are using Purdue University to validate the information that is provided through this technology. And we hope to pursue legislative approval in the next session to use this technology to actually notify and fine, if necessary, trucks that are oversized, overweight on the roadways. And so while we don't anticipate shrinking the size of our Indiana State Police Motor Carrier Enforcement Division, we don't want to do that. We want to use them for more inspection type activities, but just really being able to use this technology hopefully as a deterrent, not necessarily a money maker, but a deterrent, because we know that that one truck does as much damage to our roadways as 9,000 vehicles. And so just making sure that there's an even playing field among all carriers, and making sure that those folks that don't play that by the rules are held accountable is really what we're trying to do through this pilot program and through this technology. Also related to freight, we have a truck parking information management system program that we are working with several other Midwest states so that truck drivers know how many parking places are available ahead. And we received $4.1 million in Indiana with a, we provided the $600,000 matching portion of that. We'll have 17 different sites in Indiana, including on mostly on 65, and with a total statewide design and construction cost of almost $4 million. So construction should begin in 2017 and end in 2018. And what I think is so great about this, not only the information that's going to be provided, and the safety benefits associated with having this information for truck drivers, but just the collaboration that was, exhibited by the master of states to put together this application and to work together. And I had the great opportunity to visit with my peers from across the country at the annual ASHCO meeting. It's the American Association of State Highway Transportation Officials meeting in Boston last week. It was a wild and great lunch. And really we committed to doing more things together and to recognizing that, borders on a map really are just, made up, and that we have a lot to, there's a lot of benefit in us working together on more things. So I fully anticipate that we will just have the opportunity to look more at freight corridors and look at ways that we can support each other in our projects, understanding that the region as a whole can benefit from us working together. So I'm very optimistic about that. Well, however, this morning, we're so close.
Oh, we're so close.
I came down today. I was able to just free flow drive down there on the bridges. One project, two bridges. You guys know these, statistics better than anyone. Substantial completion this year, improvement of safety and mobility, and really just transforming the region. And what's been so apparent to me as I have been able to come down and tour the projects over the course of the last couple of years is just really being able to take a step back, look at that map, and see how these projects are really just going to transform this whole area in terms of economic development and mobility. The projected economic impact of over $87 million over the next 30 years, 15,000 new jobs, and $30 billion in personal income is what's expected with these projects. You know, the doubling of the cross-river traffic capacity, that direct link between Louisville and the Port of Indiana and Jeffersonville, and certainly opening new opportunities for all kinds of economic development in the area. You all know this, the Kennedy Bridge open, Lincoln Bridge open, reconfiguration of Spaghetti Junction. You know, I had the wonderful opportunity last year to walk the new bridge, as many of you did, on that wonderful day with those 25,000 people, and just being that part of history was really cool. And I'm looking forward to this day, the East Bay Crossing opening up. We anticipate, we're looking at, I think, the 17th, 18th, or 19th of December as the opening date. So, yeah.
Are you going to have a name for it, Mother?
I like East Bay Crossing. I mean, what's wrong with that? I don't know if we've overdone it. Okay. So, sure. You know, it requires a suggestion from the legislature, you know, and then, you know, our governor, he's off doing other stuff right now. So I don't know. The good news will be that the East Bay Crossing is going to be open.
Yep.
And so as far as the name goes, you know, I have my favorites. I like Bicentennial Bridge. No one else is like that. Indiana's Bicentennial. So we'll see. We'll see. Again, so we anticipate that within the next month, this is going to go into traffic. This project is going to be done. Hopefully. So hopefully you all have your transponders and you have your accounts set up. And hopefully, as far as I can tell, this is going to roll out. Fairly flawless. I think that they've been doing a lot of, you know, a lot of marketing and really getting the word out about the community. And then this, you know, everybody understands the benefits of you know, being able to move traffic around and really being able to you know, using connectivity and using transportation as an economic driver in our states. And certainly the reducing congestion is so important, but also just enhancing that freight mobility and fueling economic development definitely is a benefit of these projects. And the investment that's being made here is just really going to transform this area. I would love to answer any questions, talk about our tow clubhouse, talk about our chip seal, anything really that you guys might want to ask about. You guys are easy group. Awesome. Thank you for having me, and I'm excited to be here.
Sustainability, social, economic, environmental, and we'll to what they need to be successful, whether that's medical, whether it's school, whether it's a job. That's what we're about to do. You see, we have about 15 million trips per year. We have about 630 folks who work for us. A fleet of 225 buses, plus another 102 paratransit vehicles. Now, one of the things that's interesting about this park that you don't see across the board is that we own paratransit vehicles and then turn them over to a contractor who then operates them under contract. And the reason that we do that is to make sure. Used to be, you'd have a 5-year contract to do paratransit service. They'd come in with brand spanking new equipment, which 5 years later is all old and beat up. Everybody's complaining about how bad the ride was. This way we can do it on a more logical replacement schedule. One of the things that we'll take the opportunity to do, it continues to be a pleasure to work with KIPDA on the Ticket to Ride program. And I don't think that we spend enough time talking about that in terms of folks understanding how unique that is, both in terms of size, in terms of the fact that there are two major agencies, KIPDA and TARP, that work together to make that happen. Generally, what I see in other cities is folks who are trying to wrestle control and whatnot. KIPDA does an excellent job with the administrative side of all that. I like to think we do a decent job with the physical side of all of that. But in any event, there's a bunch of fans that I'm the owner of record on. Sometimes it's scary.
Insurance is your name, too.
Insurance is not our name. Yeah, that's the scary part. I think we're all cognizant of how the region has grown, and essentially the area, the land mass that we're using has expanded tremendously, the population not so much. So from our perspective, what we find ourselves doing is traveling further to provide service to the same number of folks. If you want to get into this, we actually have copies of this that the green is established employment service. Employment areas, the thicker that green circle, the more service there is there. The smaller the circles don't have it. And then the orange, or whatever that color comes across to you as, is again the thicker circle has service, the smaller, thinner ones do not. So give you some sort of sense. This is actually what I would prefer to look at, is that we keep stretching the service, right? Because, and many of you heard me do this, is because what happens is you're out here, someone decides they're gonna put another big box, Kmart, Walmart, what have you, you're gonna grow out of that, gee, can you extend the ride? So to keep the frequency up, what we do is we go hunting for additional money to put to it, and then we can extend it and keep the frequency at, say, 20 minutes. Typically, what happens is we stretch that route, and what was 20 minutes becomes 25, becomes 30, becomes 40, and roundabout in there, about an hour between buses, I would submit that we're no longer providing public transportation, we're providing a lifeline. People are going to use it, and folks who positively absolutely have to use it. People are not using it as an alternative at that point. Challenges are maintaining existing level of service. We are, current service levels out there are not sustainable, nor are they sufficient. We're not putting enough service on the street, and what we do have on the street, we cannot continue to pay for on a continual basis. So what we're always looking for is some cute little program. suburban job, the big box, the fulfillment center, Amazon, for example, in Southern Indiana, we have a tremendous partnership with them. They pay, we provide the service. We're providing some of that service, but they're also supplementing it, and they understand they need to be helping us in terms of financial support in order to get their folks back. We can go around the horn on that, essentially. Same sort of thing, covered that very much. We have just gone out, and we are doing a complete set of surveys. We've done the onboard survey, we're waiting for results of that. We will be doing a telephone survey of 500 folks randomly selected, give us a sense of what the general population feels. And then we're also doing a telephone survey of about 300 people who use TAR-3, the complementary paratransit service. We put off two phone surveys simply because we thought there was enough survey going on in the last couple of months that we didn't want to get into that. And we are waiting a little bit to sort of have everybody get over the survey hump, if you will. But the last time we did this was about 3 years ago. 44% of our trips were for work, 23% for school. So again, it's back to that notion of what people need to be successful. You know, Jefferson Community and Technical College did a study. They purchased 200 passes. They made those available for folks, first come, first serve. And then they tracked how those folks did academically against the folks who did not get a pass. And there was a marked significant difference in terms of the academic performance of the folks who no longer had to worry about paying for that ride, for being able to get on the bus. The folks who didn't get it. The things that we've continued, there's any number of partnerships. We've got a continuing partnership with the Coalition for the Homeless. Essentially, what we did years ago was said to them, they came to hit us up for free passes, but the world does. And we said to them, buy one and get one free. And we've been able to do that. They have been able to utilize those passes to get people to jobs. The hidden part of this, the unexpected part of it, is when we have problems on our system with homeless folks, we can call the center for the homeless coalition. We can give them a call, and they will have one of their coaches, one of their counselors, come out and help us in the situation and sort of talk somebody through and down and out so that we're not using the police aspect of it. And the police like that as well. You know, we're using something kind of softer and gentler and hopefully more permanent, just simply removing the situation one at a time. We also continue our safe place program. Every one of our buses is a safe place. He gets on the bus, says, hey, I need help. Driver knows not to start counseling. They have the kids sit down, makes a call on the radio saying, hey, I've got the kids safe place. One of our supervisors will go pick them up from the bus and take them over to the safe place center. We do that at Southern Indiana as well. We also do it with the Center for Women and Families. signal technology to give the bus a jump on the rest of the club. Or there's a number of different ways to do that, and so I'd be glad to talk to anybody if you want more information on that. But we'll have real-time information, the branded buses. One of the interesting things, and we've got a congestion mitigation and quality grant application in to do this, is we want to leave the bus rapid transit on Dixie Highway, get as much directness, get as much quick trip out of that, if you will. And then at various points along the way, have service feedback. So we want to focus, in the first place, we want to focus on getting folks from Dixie Highway over to Riverport. And particularly, right now, we're working with Riverport going into the holiday season to make sure that they've got enough employees and enough employees around the clock. Some of those places will be running through three shifts. The other piece is how can we get folks as far down Dixie as they need to go, and then get them from Dixie over to Riverport, or over to whatever destination on Dixie Highway. Some technological advances. We have a feed that's available for anybody who wants to use it. It's the feed that we give to Google. It essentially is all of our information relative to buses and buses, the on-time performance of those, real-time performance. And it's available for anybody who wants to put together an app. All right, we have put together an app for the zero buses downtown. There are, I think now at this point, probably half a dozen different ways, different apps that you can look at. Kind of what's an interesting piece of it is you end up having a conversation with someone who's just moved from Seattle or someplace else, and they say, why don't you use this app? I said, well, what's it going to do for you that what we already got done? Well, I kind of like your graphics, you know, so it's real interesting of what features, and people have gone out and custom-made themselves apps that have the features that they want. And then I've had someone come along and use their app, and they said, that's it too, it's too fancy, it's too many additional stuff, I just want something simple. So it's like, go shopping, pick up what you want, and move on with it. So it's a great thing to do. The other, one of, I think, the challenges that we're all going to face with is the whole role of Uber or Lyft, and those sorts of organizations. But if you think for a moment, again, about Dixie Highway, at the northern part, where you've got fairly congested neighborhoods, about as congested as you're going to get, you can have fixed rapid circulators working off of Dixie. You get a little bit further out, a little bit sparser, you start using flex route buses. Get off the route and go and do what it needs to. And then further out is the whole notion of getting Uber or Lyft or even a cab company to give people that short off to the regular routes. And we're already starting to see some of this and starting to see it as part of the solution for, in particular, folks with disabilities to get them that first or last mile, where they're then able to access park service. All right, help me with this. I've had several hundred conversations about where's TARP going to be in 10, 15, 20 years. Right? Now, the normal way to respond to, oh, we're going to have lots of streetcars, and we're going to have light rail, and we're going to have all this stuff. What I've been trying to look at is, why don't we talk about what we we want the service to be in terms of descriptors and worry about, then worry about the technology later. So I think the whole technology, starting from Uber, BRT, and then moving on to more sophisticated. So it's going to change. It's going to change rapidly. And I think it's less about what it now has a streetcar, and it's more about what it's less going on. Whether it does what I want it to do for me. We're only as good as how well we serve your trip to the front door. We're not doing that well as far as you're concerned at home. It's not working. So I want to look at that. Anybody who wants to have that discussion, I'd be glad to do that. Look at it smiling. You can tell it's the annual performance review time because the staff sucked at line pitching. But we've got Lyft as an alternative that's out there. Move to Google. And it's all about trying to secure federal, state, and local funding. And I thank you. Questions? I appreciate it. No one's headed to the table while I was talking. Thank you very much.
All right, so we have one more thing that we can squeeze in here, and we're not going to get through the entire agenda today. A year ago, staff came up with the idea that we should have some kind of recognition of projects in our region beyond, you know, the typical, yeah, that's a great project. We worked through that ourselves, we brought it to TPC, and now what happens is the TPC and TPCC members nominate projects. Well, this year we had 11 projects nominated. They are a wide variety of projects, as you'll see. We then have a working group come together, take those 11 nominations, and get that down to three. Those three then are the finalists, and they will all be recognized today. We have, as I said, a wide variety of projects. Barry didn't touch on this in his presentation, but one of the things that a really good partnership between KYTC, Louisville Metro, and TARP is to, across the entire system, methodically improve all of the stops and all the connections to the stops. There's a big focus on Preston Highway. This is a section of Preston down around just north of Mayo High School. We've got a lot of this. We've got a lot of disconnect on the sidewalks in our community. And a lot of the TARP stops, as you can see right here, sidewalk stopped up here and sidewalks on the other side of the intersection. So TARP goes through and improves the sidewalk, builds a new shelter, in some cases a shelter. The Ohio River Bridges Project, again, a wide variety of projects, is another finalist. Commissioner Hendrickson touched on that a little bit. It's a massive project. It's been years and years in the making. And it's almost complete. That's the East Infrastructure. A lot of you went on the tour back in late September to the East End Bridge. Third finalist is the 4th Street All-Electric Bus Project, and this is buses that were purchased specifically for the 4th Street line. And as Barry said, now we have the second largest electric bus fleet in the country. I know Indianapolis is going to have an all-electric BRT shortly, and we're a little envious of that, but we'll get there. There's one of the 4th Street buses. They look a little bit different than the Zero bus that's used downtown. And the winner is...
Yes, I'm not taking it away.
Yeah, don't take it away. Thank you.
I have, what is this?
What's that?
Well, I'm alternating between red and blue. And we're pretending that it's Indiana red, but it's really part of red, so.
Do you want to do that?
Mr. Parker?
Thank you, guys.
And also, thank you for your indulgence with that. The other thing that I want to do is, back in September at the Indiana MPO Council meeting, the MPO Council, at the MPO Conference, the MPO Council awarded the Water Bridges Project the Transportation Award for the year. Ms. Hendrickson received that at the conference, and this is an identical award, hopefully. It says the same, for the transportation. And that's it, I guess. We're a little bit behind, so they're going to move the board meeting in here shortly. And as you heard, they were a little loud at the hall. I think they want in.
So I've got to need a motion to go there.
I've got one comment for, excuse me. 1984, our mayor was reigned, that's 42 years ago. And I think there are some minutes, might be that somebody made a motion at the meeting in 1983 or 4 to move the Ohio River project forward. That's happened 42 years ago. And through that time, Bobby said, I'll never see it in my lifetime. Now, I guess the question I'd have this group, you younger folks, is, what would it be as we think 30, 40 years down the road that we could put on the drawing board to say what is going to be as significant for the future in the next 20, 30, 40 years for this area than those bridges? You know,
flying cars.
Huh?
Flying cars.
I don't know. Flying cars? My people. Yes.
Five seconds before we adjourn.
I just wanted that the last item on the agenda is the administrative modifications of the transportation improvement program. Just very quickly, just wanted to let you know that on the table are some modifications that matter, changes, and no action is needed by the committee, but it's needed to let you go about this. So thank you very much.
Any other business? Motion to adjourn. Those in second, anybody in check? Five.